Hello and thanks once again for taking the time to download and listen to our podcast on CelticUnderground.net. I'm Harry Brady and this is a Christmas special, crossover podcast special, Christmas one. It's me and the guys from At By Them In Celtic, along with Lawrence's Smoke Alarm. It's the festive period, so I wanted to do something a wee bit different on this week's podcast. The festive season is also known as a period of goodwill to all men, so I thought I'd extend that olive branch across to Lawrence Donegan and the guys at the At By Them In Celtic podcast. They've had me on their podcast, so it's only fair that I reciprocate and have them on. So this week we are joined by Mr Remy McSwain, Lawrence Donegan, and of course we can't have those two guys without Lawrence's Smoke Alarm. So we invite them all across to the Celtic Underground podcast. We discuss the Celtic Motherwell game, where Celtic are with Brendan Rodgers, and then move on to something that Lawrence touched on the last At By Them In podcast, and that is the state of punditry, or more specifically, coverage of Scottish football by BBC Sportsound, and a bit of by Clyde. Anyway, enough of me. Just one more thing to say. Get your change ready for Saturday. The game against Dundee is the annual pre-Christmas bucket collection for the Celtic FC Foundation. Hope you enjoy the podcast. This is me, Harry Brady, with them, Mr. Remy McSwain and Mr. Lawrence Donegan. So I'm joined this week, as I'm joined every week. No, no, that's somebody else's podcast. We have a special face-off transformation. I was on their podcast last week. So this week, as a Christmas bumper special, I am joined by Remy McSwain and Lawrence Donegan. How are you doing, guys? How are you doing, Remy?
I'm very good. Very good, Harry. Thanks for having us on.
And Lawrence, how are you?
Dodging away. I always like to go on and save your failing podcast, Harry.
Surf's, you've even missed the surf. I believe surf's up in California at this time of year.
Surf is up in California. My pal texted me this morning. He's going to Ocean Beach, which is there's a big wave at Ocean Beach, and I've never been there. I'm not a very good surfer, but I was going to go.
Are you not too old for a midlife crisis?
Hang on a second. I say I'm a terrible surfer, but as I say, it was going to be a big day, so I was quite happy to get the excuse not to go to Ocean Beach.
And so you swapped Ocean Beach for sitting in front of Celtic TV to watch the Celtic Hamilton game. Great swap.
Maybe after having watched the game, I'm not so sure if it's such a great swap. But anyway, I'm going for the completest season. I'm trying to watch every game. I don't think I have watched every game. Anyway, so I sat in and watched it. I put it on the... Our lad's got a big Apple computer screen, so I put the Celtic TV on there and watched the game. I'm not sure we'll talk about it, but it certainly wasn't the best of the season. Let's put it like that.
You managed to stay awake?
Oh, it was pretty brutal, to be honest. I saw you, Remy, you put your worst domestic performance of the season. I said that as well. I was doing the minute by minute, and... it was definitely our worst performance in the league so far this season. I kept waiting for us to kind of kick into life, but it never really happened. It was weird.
Well, Remy, we'll start off with the team selection. So, finally succumbed to the why can't we just play two up front and take advantage of all the chances created by the guys in midfield. So, first of all, were you surprised at two up front?
Yes, I was. I was more surprised, though, by the lack of fullbacks and no width in the team, but I thought he was just going to keep playing one of Griffiths or Dembele. Very surprised to see the two of them playing, and the midfield, just even looking at it before the game, looked a bit unbalanced and disjointed. You hoped it would. I think it may have been it was actually the midfield that played against Motherwell in the second half, wasn't it?
I think it was,
but,
yeah.
But they didn't play as a diamond. They played in a different shape. And I think it's fair to say it didn't work.
Lawrence, your thoughts?
Well, I just thought it was a total mess. I mean, we played three at the back, two up front, and in the midfield, God knows who was playing where. I mean, Roberts was kind of out in the right. I want to talk about Patrick Roberts at some point, by the way. He's beginning to annoy me. But other than that, it just seemed like a bit of a mess. And I think it all stemmed from the two up front. I don't know if we knew what the players knew what they were meant to be doing. They seemed to be getting in each other's way. McGregor, God knows what he was doing. I mean, I barely noticed he was playing. The issue with that I have with Roberts is that he's definitely not a Brendan Rodgers kind of player. There's no way Brendan Rodgers is going to spend money on Patrick Roberts because he slows the game down. The one good thing I saw in the game, actually, was we moved the ball pretty quickly. That's a huge difference from last year.
Do you think we moved the ball quickly tonight? I suppose we moved all season.
Yeah, I thought our problem tonight was we moved the ball far too slowly.
Well, but I mean, if you'd let me finish, you know, interrupt me on my own podcast, and now I can't get. But it's relative to last season. We still moved the ball pretty quickly. But just going back to the, I just thought it was amazing. I don't think anybody really knew. I mean, we were playing formation that the players didn't understand or had forgotten about as soon as they stepped onto the pitch. It was a bit of a mess, I have to say. I have to say, I kind of miss. I'm not a big fan of three at the back from what I've seen this year. I think both Tierney, but I think we miss what Tierney and Izaguirre bring us down the left side a lot. But it was a pretty disjointed and I tell you what, it was one again. I mean, again, the difference last year, you know, you're 1-0 with 5 minutes to go, you're really panicking. I mean, I was only slightly panicking tonight. I mean, there was a couple of incidents in the last 2 or 3 minutes. By and large, we kind of eased out of the game. But it was certainly wasn't a great watch. But given what we've seen so far this season, of course we're going to forgive them that. They're allowed to play badly one night.
Have you noticed, Remy, he's just done what he criticises you for doing on the By The Minute podcast?
Yes, exactly.
He's just done the whole game and got to the
whole game. you've got to build it up, I'm told. The only thing he missed there was injury time.
That's right. Sorry, Harry, go back.
Yeah, good grief, man. And I've also noticed that, in addition to you two, the smoke alarm has had a free transfer across this podcast as well.
Give me a sec.
The most successful guest in the By The Minute podcast.
So, all the way back to the beginning.
Right,
That's all right.
But so, hang on, Harry.
Yes.
You get the point, though. It was a mess. I mean, it just was a mess, wasn't it? I mean, if somebody asked me what the formation was, I wouldn't be able to tell them.
And not to also do the thing of jump ahead, but you're saying about three at the back. I actually felt for most of the second half we played two at the back.
Yeah.
We did.
But winding all the way back to the beginning of the game, so we've got two up front. And Hamilton, now I didn't hear this, but apparently, I couldn't tell you the Hamilton team, but apparently Hamilton only had two recognised defenders on the park.
Well, Donati was playing sweeper, wasn't he?
Yeah. I just got the impression that Donati is their best footballer, so they just had Donati at the back organising everything. So, Remy, give me your summation of the first 40 minutes. We start the game with two up front. Lawrence just identified that we're not quite sure where everybody's playing, so give me a summation of the first 40 minutes.
I think Lawrence's summation is pretty accurate, that nobody seemed to know where they were playing. I think we looked like we played a 3-1-4-2 with Brown just in front of the three and dropped in when any of the defenders went forward, and it was mainly Simonovic who went forward. But we completely lacked spark and flair, and the only person who seemed to be actually doing anything was Roberts, but Dembele and Griffiths were really, really poor. Griffiths kept moving out of the wing and over-hitting and under-hitting crosses, and we didn't look at scoring. I'm pretty sure the goal was the first shot on target.
Do you know, I think, Lawrence, that part of the problem is if we're now the likes of Griffiths, Dembele are used to playing as the focal point in a one, they're not actually practising, they're not used to playing with a partner.
With a partner, although ironically, the goal was a kind of partner thing, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yep.
But they are, they kind of get in each other's way. I think of the two, Griffiths looks a bit more willing to adapt, whereas Dembele seems, I mean, I'm sure he's not, but to me, with his body language, he seems slightly in the huff, you know, that he's that his space is limited. I don't think he makes the kind of runs that he should do if he's playing with a striking partner. When he gathers the ball in, his first instinct is to try and work himself some space and just take a pop. And frankly, right now, his confidence is at such a level that he can't really work himself space, like, even against a team like Hamilton. And he doesn't have the pace to just burn people off. I mean, he's quick enough, but he's not quick enough to burn people off. So that's really, it doesn't work. But I thought, I mean, Roberts obviously was the eye-catching thing, but again, I've already made my point about Roberts. But for the front two, it really isn't working. So, go on, Harry.
No, I was going to say, more detail about what's your issue with Roberts.
Well, I just think I was thinking about this during the game. The issue is, he slows the ball down. His first instinct is to get the ball and cut back, cut inside. So that move by his very nature slows the game down. If a left-footed player's playing on the right side, it's going to slow the game down, isn't it?
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm thinking, well, that's really bugging me. I mean, he's skillful enough, but he wasn't. I mean, he was getting past Dougie Emery, but Dougie Emery's about 47, you know, and he's still, you know, Dougie Emery won his fair share of tackles against Roberts, and the problem is Roberts doesn't have enough pace. Well, that's the difference between Roberts and Forrest. I can see why Rogers prefers Forrest to Roberts if both are fit. You can't play. So your first instinct is to say, well, Roberts should play on the left, but he's not quick enough. He's not quick enough to go down the outside. He just doesn't have the pace. So you can see why he plays on the right, but again, by the very nature of that, it slows the game down. I mean, he's a very tricky. You know, he looks like the kind of player that Rangers. I mean, he's obviously much, 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 much better than that. But he's the kind of player that Rangers are. You know, small and tricky and kind of a schoolyard kind of player. But for the type of footballer we want to play, I'm not sure he's the right kind.
Isn't it amazing that it's turned into an insult? He's the type of player that might play for Rangers.
I know. You know what I mean? He's like I used to watch the Rangers game on Saturday. He's like a, you know, like a Barry McKay kind of guy, you know?
Sorry, Harry. Can I just do your job for a second and ask Lawrence a question?
On you go.
How was the great Callum Patterson on Saturday?
Oh, he was absolutely immense. That was a career record. If I'm there scouting for Celtic, my report was in, and we're not signing him.
Did he not score the goal that's been disallowed?
Oh, no, he believed the passer.
Right.
But I think Harry and I told you the guy was mince. Maybe now you've seen it for your own eyes.
Well, it's one game, isn't it?
I know. I'm not diverting, but I spoke to a Hearts fan today who said it was a typical Hearts away performance that they've had every game this season.
Yeah, it was. They were very, very, very poor. And I know it's the first game, and it was Cathro's first game, and we're all still looking to read a lot into it. And I'm probably reading far too much into it, but I thought the players did not put a shift in for him. Last 30 minutes, Patterson was one of the majorly guilty ones. There's a couple of times when McKay ran away from him, and he just started jogging. It was, I couldn't believe what I was watching. Anyway, so you'll be happy. Oh, anyway.
So back on to us. Remy, what did you think of Rogic tonight?
I thought he put a great pass through for the first goal.
Mm-hmm.
He had a couple of fantastic touches and turns. And he had a brilliant shot. I thought he'd burst the net near the end. A tremendous shot. As soon as he hit it, I was up because I thought it was in the top corner. But apart from that, he was pretty quiet. But, you know, he can't be great every game. And it's like the team, we've all been so upbeat and optimistic. And, you know, tonight people were looking forward to going to a midweek game in December against Hamilton. We haven't had that for a long time.
Yeah, because I thought there was a better crowd than I thought. I thought there'd be mid, particularly going. got there in no time. I thought, oh God, there's going to be about 35,000 here. I thought it was maybe closer to 40.
I think the official attendance, I believe, was 55,000. there certainly wasn't that. I think they'd Craig White's calculator for that one, but it certainly wasn't that. But it was a decent crowd. But people were talking. People were buzzing. I mean, I think was that our sixth home league game?
Yeah.
So we've not had a home league game for about 6 weeks. People were looking forward to it. And, you know, unfortunately, our expectations just now are massive because we're all enjoying seeing us whack 4 and 5 goals in every game. And, you know, we can't do it every game. But the major plus is that we won.
I thought Roderick's performance sort of summed up the game in that he kept overdoing stuff.
And he nearly made the pass a lot of times. You know, he was trying to thread the perfect ball, and he either under hit it or over hit it, and the guy got a leg in to, you know, just divert it. But I agree with you. He just wasn't the way he's been playing of late. But you know, if that shot had gone in, that's all we would have been talking about tonight, because that would have been the best moment of the game by a long way.
And the goal, Lawrence, you've seen it on the telly. My gut feel at the game was Roderick played the through ball that either Dembele or Griffiths could have picked up. My gut feel at the game was Griffiths had gone just a bit too early, and if he'd have picked it up, he was offside.
Oh, I don't look at these things in such close detail, Harry.
Oh, come on. You're supposed to be our video analyst who tells us.
I have a more impressionistic eye on these things. Here, just talking about the anticipation for the game, though, you're right, Remy, about I am actually at the stage now where I'm anticipating the release of the team. I'm checking the internet, you know, at 5:30. Wait, is the team up yet? that's how excited I am, you know, because you want to see what Rodgers is going to do, you know. You're thinking, you were expecting something different tonight, weren't you? So I was really, really interested. I'd forgotten about the Dembele Griffiths thing, but I suppose that was a big shock. But the team, the release of the team, is exciting these days. In terms of the goal, well, what I can remember of it, I mean, I've got it here on my screen, but I won't play it. It was a great through pass from Roderick. But the thing that struck me was Dembele. If he had any confidence, he would have gone. And I mean, it's great that he passed it to his teammate. But if he'd had any confidence, he would have tried to bury that. I think he's having a real, not a crisis, but he's pretty low in confidence right now. It's a nice slip pass to Griffiths, who almost conspired to not score.
I thought we weren't going to score. I thought we'd managed to blow a 2-on-1.
No, it was a 1-on-none. It was a 1-on-none. He had nobody to beat.
And then shortly after that, we had another one.
Yeah. Griffiths was right through,
and I don't know if you noticed this at the game, Remy, but see, after he'd shot,
Dembele went mental.
Correct.
Oh, did he? I never saw that.
Because Dembele was waiting on a cutback.
It was almost as if he was looking at Griffiths saying,
I just gave you a goal, why did you not pass to me?
So getting back to the earlier point about the body language and... I thought that his negative body language, I thought that summed it up.
See, on that one, the Griffiths, well, that was, as opposed to the goal, which was a 1-on-none, that one was a 1-on-1. Uh-huh. I don't think Dembele had any right to want that. I mean, Griffiths, that was Griffiths' all day. He should have scored.
Griffiths should have scored, but the problem, as Harry's saying, we're watching a game and we get one look at it.
Yeah.
I didn't see whether Dembele was free until I saw his reaction, but he was shouting at Griffiths, like, you know, you should have passed that to me. But just watching the game, I thought Griffiths was through and should score. You know, it was Griffiths' chance to take or miss. And, you know, unfortunately, like he did most of the night, his finishing was absolutely woeful.
Because it didn't even enter my head that you should do anything and have a go, as you say, Remy, until after the ball's gone past, you notice Dembele standing there.
Here, I'm just watching a replay of the goal there. I'm going to take that back. That was Dembele did the right thing there, slipping
into Griffiths. He did what Henry Larsson used to do. He played it to the player who was the best opportunity to score. And as you say, Griffiths nearly conspired to miss it. But I think I just summed up the game. Even our goal was crap.
You were actually thinking, this is just before half time, so they'll get in. Brendan will shake them up a bit. They're now one up. It'll be better second half.
Yep.
And was it, Remy?
It was actually worse, I think, the second half. I thought he would hook McGregor at half time and put somebody on to try and give a bit more width or pace or something. And he didn't. The same team came out, and I thought he's maybe going to change the shape a bit. And as you said earlier on, Harry, I think the change he made was he went two at the back.
Aye.
And pushed Lustig much further on, and Brown kind of filled in the middle from time to time, but we seemed to be playing two at the back, and it was like, you know, to be fair, Hamilton were not causing us any problems at that time in the game, and we created a few chances, but we actually didn't make the goalkeeper work at all. Our finishing was so bad tonight that a lot of our chances weren't even on target, so there was no rebounds or anything to pick up. We just, our shooting was poor the whole game.
Because you get replays on telly, I think sometimes you remember chances more when you're watching it on the telly, Lawrence. As Remy's just said, I can think of Armstrong having
Armstrong,
one that just
Griffiths
went past.
Had one. Griffiths had one. Dembele had the one that he blocked the keeper clearance.
Dembele
he went off for the header and put it wide.
Well, Dembele also had the ball in the net, didn't he, early on?
Earlier on. But Rodgick put the ball in the net when it pulled back for a foul as well, but you know, the whistle had gone long before it.
But second half...
Well, hang on, Harry. Sorry, I know it's your podcast.
On you go.
Well, just before we get into that, you know what's? I don't want to get this is too negative, by the way. So we'll I want to talk about this in that kind of frame. I acknowledge it's just a relentless stream of negativity. But I think we had 7 or 8 corners in the first half. Does anybody notice how bad we are getting at corners? We used to score goals from corners.
Well, we had one good corner, Griffiths. Griffiths pulled one back low at England and Man United.
That was a great
Sheringham.
Great
and
corner.
And it got bloated over the bar, but most of our corners were... We actually hit 2 or 3 short corners tonight, which don't start me because I loathe them, but most of our corners were either under or over hit. We kept changing the corner taker as well, which kind of said everything. You just have to write it off as a fairly bad day at the office, but we won. That was the important thing. We got the win, we got a clean sheet. But 11 points clear, somewhat 300 goals ahead, and still got 2 games in hand.
And
our lights lasted the whole game.
Correct, yes. It struck me, it was a typical December against a rubbishy team that we expect to win performance. We've had them under Martin O'Neill, mm-hmm. Neil Lennon, Stratton. The thing about the short corners, though, it was almost as if yesterday afternoon we'd practice short corners for 5 minutes and decided we were going to trial them out in the game.
Well, they were all, well, apart from that one that Remy talked about, I think it was Rodgick with the shot from that corner. It wasn't a bad effort. And the guy blocked it. The guy got in front of him. So, but that was a really smart corner, but that was it. But even under Ronnie, we scored a lot more goals from corners. You know, and it's not like we're midgets. I mean, it's hard to tell.
Simeonovic had a great chance with a header.
He put over the bar.
He should have scored that.
Yeah.
Actually, now we're talking about us, Harry, we should have won him at 9-0.
No. Even though we're fish.
In fairness, I don't think we're giving Hamilton enough credit. I thought they did. Although, of all the teams that have come to Celtic Park this year, they might have come with the least ambition of anyone. I mean, they really did. I mean, I'm looking here. I think they had the first shot on target was in the 50th minute when Ali Crawford shot from about 46 yards.
Yeah.
But that was it. I thought they
worked their socks off. They were pretty well organised. They were pretty disciplined. They've got a couple of no-bad-wee players, but they had no cutting edge whatsoever. Anyway, they'd have taken a 1-0 before the game, I think. And it was only in the last 5 minutes when they thought, hey, we might get something here. And Svyatchenko decided to turn into the white Boyata. He just an absolute nightmare for 5 minutes.
It was
terrible.
There was a bit in the game as well where, because in the last 15 minutes, you're right, or 10 minutes, Remy, they decided to put 3 against 3 up front. And there was a bit where Craig Gordon had the ball.
Oh, yeah.
But my brother turned to me and said, Can you imagine how much we'd be crapping our pants if Effie was one of the back three?
That's the difference.
Yeah, you forget that we've now got confidence that they're playing that about. And I think Beaton also arsed it up not long after he came on and gave them a chance.
Yeah.
But as you say, Remy, the positives of it are we are umpty-dumpty points clear, a million goals clear, and there's a good chance we could win the league by
March. Yeah, yeah. Barry Mackay says they'll fight to the last day of the season, but nobody told them it was March the 28th, because that's roughly when it should be over.
Here's the thing.
Go on.
What would the authorities do if we end up we win at Celtic Park against Rangers and we win the league?
When's that game, Harry?
March the 11th.
Is it possible? I bet you've sat down with a little bit of paper and worked this out.
If we beat Hearts, Aberdeen and Rangers in the games that we are due to play them, and we drop 6 points in other games between now and then, and they play as they've been playing, we will win the league sometime in the two games before that or the game after.
Yeah, but I think we're on course for the earliest league win ever, aren't we?
Yeah, and I never realised there's been twice that the top flight in Scotland has been won with a team not losing a game. Both of those seasons were 18-game seasons. Prior to the turn of the last century.
I was going to say that, the 19th century.
Yeah.
When did Lennon's team went? Did they go to February? Remember the boy, the wonder goal from the boy from Aberdeen scored? They won 2-1, they went 2-0 up.
Yeah, Hayes scored. Yeah, that's right. That was about February, yeah.
And then, of course, there was Tommy Burns' team that only lost one game all season. And finished
sixth. Yeah.
So, Brendan, I'm sure Brendan's aware of all these types of things.
I wonder if that's one of his 7 targets that he was talking about last week.
Nah.
I never heard that. What was he saying?
So did he not tell you? Oh, no,
he never told me. Okay.
Oh, no.
I heard that
it was an interview with, I think it was Chris McLaughlin before the Thistle game. I heard it on the way to the game. I took the car. And he was talking about how when they'd gone away to pre-season, they'd set 7 targets or goals for the season and they'd achieved the first 2. Right, so obviously qualifying for Champions League was one, and winning the League Cup was one of the other ones. So they were trying to work out. He wouldn't tell them what the other 5 were, but obviously one of them was to win the league, and one was to win the Scottish Cup. So that got them to 4, and they were trying to work out what the other 3 targets were.
Obviously, don't like Chris Commons back on the premises.
Right, okay, so he's achieved that one.
Or Scott Allen. Is that his loan deal done?
No, he's injured. I don't think he'll be going back. He's not getting a game. But anyway, what are his other 3 targets? Is it to go unbeaten, score the record number of goals, win the record number of points? What are they?
I reckon that one target would be to score 100 goals.
Right. Okay, so that would be 5. So what's the other 2?
Maybe one of the targets was to be in Europe past Christmas?
No, he said that the other 5 targets were all achievable. I'm wondering whether one of them's a whitewash on the Mankey mob.
I think that will be one.
Have we mentioned the triple? That's obviously one, isn't it?
Well, yeah, that's about when the Scottish Cup's won, yeah. So there's maybe 1 or 2 left that we don't know about, but he did not publicly declare what they were last week, but it was just an interview with Chris McLaughlin. I don't know if he'll be kicking about in iPlayer radio or whatever, but it was quite an interesting listen. It was before the Thistle game last week.
So with all these points clear, how would you sum up so far this season? Max out of 10.
Hang on a minute.
Yes, what?
Did that last week?
What?
No, that was Europe.
That was Europe.
That was Europe, that's right.
Because they're going to ask you a question that relates to your marks out of 10.
Well, I'm going to say got to be close to 10. How can it not be close to 10? I mean, tonight, if you think tonight's the kind of most, I mean, and I put the word in inverted commas, disappointing night, it's not in any way disappointing. We've got 3 points. I mean, the style of play, the tactics, the results, it's been magical. It's a long time since, not a long time since the Martin O'Neill days, but were they as good as this? I suppose you'll say they were, Remy. But I've loved it. I've absolutely loved it. 9.8 out of 10, maybe?
Remy?
Yeah, it's got to be close to a 10. It's hard to say 10, because no doubt you've got a wee list there, Harry, of something that went wrong. But
no, I've not.
I'll go 9.5.
Because the point I was going to make is, I think it's going to get better. That's why I was asking marks out of 10. Because I think it's going to get better.
I think it's going to get better because I can't envisage that in 4 or 5 months, guys like Gary Mackay, Stephen, and I know he's only filling in just now, but Callum McGregor will be bench at best. We are going to have better players and better players who will move the ball quicker and will understand what Rodgers is trying to do, but not only understand it, we'll be able to do it. And I just want to see them bedded in before the end of the season and not to be nervous about the qualifiers next year, because those we've never, apart from under Martin O'Neill, we've never cruised through those qualifiers. It's always nerve shredding. They're horrific, and I just like to go into them thinking we're going to breeze this, and I think with the current manager there's a really good chance that we will do that.
And the other thing about it that struck me tonight about we're going to get better, he has been playing the same core of people. I mean, we talked about the team tonight, but basically there's a core of about 14, 15 people that you were saying, Lawrence, about being excited about picking the team. There's a core of 14, 15 people that excitement of the team will come from that core.
I know, isn't it pathetic? And I still get excited. But that's what he's done. It's just, it's brilliant. I mean, I don't know, I keep on repeating myself here, but it's you know, Remy will be right. I'll be interested, you know, can it get any better? God, it's hard to see how it can get any better. But I suppose, I mean, if he lives up to the promise of bringing in a couple of players, high-quality players. I'll tell you the other thing before we forget about tonight's game. We're missing two automatic first picks, Forrest and Sinclair. I think we're really...
Three. Tierney
as well. Well, yeah. Although Izzy's done really well.
But when Tierney's fit, he'll be straight back in as a first pick.
The Sinclair injury, I don't know if it's... Has anybody heard anything about that? Or has anybody heard anything about the Forest?
Rodgers has said that Sinclair might be fit for Saturday against Dundee, and he was pictured in training yesterday. Forest has got a hamstring injury, and they said he expected him to be out for about 3 weeks. So that's a week away. That's Forest done a week already. So he should, if he's telling the truth, he should be back for probably the Ross County game.
And the other thing out of that core 14, 15 people, and it's clear on nights like tonight, who's going to be the people who make way out of the squad to create the space for the new players to come in?
Yeah.
So is your mate Chris Commons going to your mate Neil Lennon?
I can't see how Hibs can afford him unless Celtic are very, very generous.
But he's only got 6 months left in a contract.
He has only got 6 months, but, you know, the wages he gets, I mean, are Celtic just going to say you can go for nothing or we'll give you whatever to go? I don't know, but Hibs certainly can't afford these wages.
Are Celtic sitting against Dundee United right now?
You what?
Have Celtic got anything against Dundee? How is our relationship with Dundee United?
No, I don't think we've got anything against Dundee United just now, I think.
Should we not hate them for giving us chifty? No.
We said, right, we'll give comments to Hibs.
Well, there you go. I mean, there's chifty. I mean, nothing against him. I'm just not sure that Liam Henderson's got a future under Brendan?
I don't see it either with him. Now, Christie, I think, might need to go on loan because he's not got enough games. Chifty will go, Ambrose will go, Bayata might be sold. You could probably see Scott Allen being punted. He might end up at Hibs, I don't know. Or Dundee United again, because he's not going to make it was.
The most high profile or the biggest one is Beaton is clearly not in the picture.
No.
His role now is 10 minutes to the end to show up the game.
Yep.
That's it.
So we change all that and then we bring in the midfielders. Do you know the thing that's really struck me as well? There's been no talk in the media about who we might be bringing in at all.
Now, apart from McCarthy, there's a story about him in the paper nearly every day.
That's only because they listen to you on By the Minute. Are you getting
If the Daily Record are stealing my rumours, Jesus Christ,
they're in bigger trouble than we thought.
Are you getting a cut from the agent?
Oh, jeez. I was going to send about Stan Collymore out there. I was going to say it was a chance meeting in a car park, but that is basically all it was.
But anyway, so, I shouldn't talk about giving agents a cut when I'm sitting in a Glasgow property. So, the other thing I wanted to talk to you about, Lawrence, because it was a bit of your thing last week. I haven't heard it. Billy Brown last night on Sportsound.
Oh my God.
What was so? Because you tweeted about it. Did you not tweet about it, Lawrence?
Some boy got on to me about it. It was he was on.
It was me. I told you about it last night.
For you, yeah. So I went and listened to it. You know, I'm trying my best not to, but I can't stop myself. It was quite remarkable. You had Charlie Richmond. Is that the old referee?
Yeah.
So they're talking about two things. Well, the main thing, obviously, because hosted by Kenny McIntyre, so it's obviously always got to be about Rangers. They're talking about the Rangers game and the goal. Jamie Walker got booked. It was the most ludicrous. He got sived down and he got booked for diving. And the Charlie Richmond character, he says, he remembered you, but Walker stole that penalty off us in the first game of the season, remember?
Yeah.
And Beaton was the ref who got conned. And basically libelled Beaton, saying, oh, he only booked Jamie Walker because Walker had conned him in the first game of the season, which is a kind of serious calumny or a serious accusation about a referee that would hold a grudge. But the main thing was then it got on to Cathro, and Billy Brown just went into Cathro. You know, he obviously hates Craig Levein because as soon as Levein got to Hearts, he cleared him and Gary Lockhart. Mm-hmm. So he slaughtered Levein. Oh, Levine's great, he'd say in the first sentence, and then the next sentence he would just put the boot in. And then he said, I've got nothing against Cathro, but he's got no experience, and it was totally incoherent, you know, contradicting himself within the space of a sentence. You know, as I said back to the boy on Twitter, it's just the dregs of football punditry.
He basically said that Craig Levein was still managing Hearts under Robbie Nielsen as well, sending him down notes, telling him what to do, and who to put on as a sub, etc., which all sounded like a load of crap, but he, as Lauren said, he obviously loathes Levein, so well done, Craig, for sacking that fud, because he really is a bitter, bitter wee man. And it, as Kenny McIntyre was, you know, do you get decisions in Glasgow? And he started talking about the decisions he hadn't had at Ibrox, and of course Kenny McIntyre then says, yes, it's really, you probably don't get decisions against Rangers and Celtic. It's like, well, what's it got to do with us? You know? It's nothing to do with us at all. That these decisions were a game on Saturday that are nothing to do with us. But the old false equivalence is brought in again for balance.
Sorry, go on. I was just going to say, Harry, my main beef with this is, you know, it's just the same crowd of people, you know, talking in a kind of gilded circle. And it's there's no insight or there's no... Well, there is a... I mean, Scott McDonald's a bit of a fresh voice, but people will say, oh, that's all because he's kind of pro-Celtic. Well, I'm not so sure he is.
I thought he was all right.
He is. He's good. You know, and he went as far as a current player could go on that show last night on the refereeing stuff. You know, he had a go at the linesman. There was a linesman who gave the offside, I think, the Arse goal chopped off. And there was a linesman who got the Motherwell goal chopped off at Dundee, and McDonald, who is good, you know, he's a current player, and he went quite a long way. So that's good. But by and large, that whole scene is just, you know, it's the same tired old voices, and they're mostly, you know, ex-players, and they've mostly all played for Rangers.
And they're all desperate for Cathro to fail.
And they're all desperate for him to fail, you know. And by the way, having seen that game on Saturday, he's got a job to do. But I mean, who knows? They're definitely. I mean,
Jansen lost his first two games, so I wouldn't be. You know, you can't write him off based on one game.
And as you say, Harry, Hearts are a much different proposition away than they are at home, aren't they?
Yeah, and Rangers are a different proposition away than they are at home.
Yeah.
In the same way, but. Your point about, this is the other thing about Sportsound. So, the biggest game in Scotland on Saturday, because we'd played on Friday night, was Rangers Hearts. No coverage, no live radio commentary.
Are you not banned?
The week before, the biggest game in Scotland at 3 PM kickoff was Rangers Aberdeen, no live radio commentary.
Yeah, but I think they're banned from Ibrox.
They're not.
Chris McLaughlin is banned from Ibrox, so as a consequence, the BBC won't send anybody else.
Well, quite right.
Oh, I agree. What I don't understand is why the SPFL aren't knocking on Rangers' door saying, this is our main radio media partner. Sort yourselves out or we're withholding your money. Because that would fix it overnight.
And there doesn't seem to be any good reason behind it other than the fact that Jim Traynor hates the BBC.
And then the other thing is your point about Kenny McIntyre. You know, they've got Richard Wilson, the Dave King fan club. I don't understand why they continually persist in trying to get Rangers people on in an effort. I think it's a genuine effort to get Rangers fans to get listening to it. But they've got no coverage of it, so what's the point?
Can I just say a word in defence of Richard Wilson? Certainly from
what
I am. Because that little poison is the poison dwarf, Brown, is slaughtering Cathro about the Newcastle thing, saying, oh, well, you know, not from what I've heard that he does need, to coach first team players. He's a video analyst. And Richard Wilson saying, well, that's not true. You know, and Brown says, well, how do you know? And Richard Wilson stuck up for his own journalism, which is, I thought, you know, fair enough, pal, because this shouldn't be. Because the last boy that did it, I can't even remember his name now, the boy who slaughtered Cathro last week. What was his name again, Harry? Can you remember?
Willie Miller was one last
week.
Was his name Fulton?
Jamie Fulton. He's disappeared off the BBC. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
He's gone. Well, what he said was libelous. Anyway. So, sorry, I interrupt you, but just in defence of...
But do you not think this is all part of an anti... It's very much an anti-education thing. That the big beef these people have got is...
Yes.
This is a guy who... It's almost like in any sort of industry where the beef is about the young guys coming through who've got qualifications. What do they know? They may have qualifications, but they've not got common sense, that crap that people come out with. It's just nonsense.
It is. I think you're absolutely right. But you've got to remember where these people are coming from. I mean, Scotland has basically been run by the large mafia for years. Scottish football, the upper echelons. And there's a new generation coming along, and they're picking away at the edges, and the old guard are kicking and squealing and biting. I mean, this is the last stand we're seeing here.
There's that coach in Germany whose name escapes me.
Hoffenheim.
He's 29.
28 or 29, yeah.
And here we are still decrying that, you know, it's still that concept of, well, a wee whiskey at half-time never hurt Paul Gascoigne. It's all that nonsense. You know, who thought that having Chris Boyd give their opinion on this was of any value whatsoever?
Go on, Harry, Remy.
I was just going to say there was a fire alarm was chirping in there. That was all.
Yeah, even the fire alarm.
The fire alarm's got a view in Cathro.
Yeah.
But Harry, I don't know about you, but our podcast numbers are going up and up and up. And I'm not saying, and we're pretty terrible broadcasters, right? But, I mean, I know part of the reason is club specific, our podcast. And I speak to one of the boys that does a Rangers podcast, and his numbers are really good as well. And it's club specific. But our podcast. Well, Rangers. Right. But
that was quite a good joke there, Harry.
But the point is, we're talking about. See, when you and I go to the pub, Harry, or Remy, when you go to the pub, Remy, you drink too much. No, I'm only joking. Do we sit and talk about transfer rumours?
No.
We have a laugh, don't we? It's a quick, you know, like 5 seconds, who's coming, laugh, and then we go on to talk. What do we talk about? We talk about tactics, talk about formations.
Well, that was the whole point. What was the first 15, 20 minutes of this podcast? It was discussing the fact the manager had gone 3-5-2. And whether it worked.
It was discussing the fact that we didn't know what the manager had done.
Well, yeah.
I'm sure Lawrence's formation added up to 13.
But it gets back to when I did the podcast with Tom English, and he was being a bit critical, and he was saying that there's more coverage of football in the papers than ever before. And yes, there is. But
it's terrible.
You've now got 8 pages saying the same thing as you used to have 3 pages saying.
And it's all rubbish. Yeah, just occasionally they get it right. Now, I'm going to confess something. There was a few weeks ago, I listened to the Radio Clyde podcast, and it was not about, who's the guy that runs it, Jerry something or other?
Jerry McCullough.
He announced, we're going to have a show tomorrow night about developing talent in Scotland. I want all the football coaches to phone in. And lo and behold, the next night, I don't know who the pundits were. It was obviously not Diddy Johnson or Hugh Keevans. It was people who were actually, you know, not ossified. And it was a really interesting show, because it was all these guys from the west coast of Scotland who were coaching good youth teams, clearly. These guys knew what they were talking about. And it was 2 hours of really good listening. Guys with lots of suggestions, lots of ideas, lots of experience, you know, identifying what was going wrong in Scottish football. And it was a great listen. It was an absolutely fantastic listen. I loved it. It was easily the best Radio Clyde show I've heard in years. In years.
But it's interesting you say that, because I don't know if you come across this, Remy. Just as you were talking there, I was thinking about people that I've met through business in the last couple of years who are not interested in football. Who, when somebody introduces me and says that I'm interested in football, the person says, oh, do you know what? I'm not that interested in football, but I do love listening to the phone-in shows when I'm coming home from work, because they're a really good laugh. And I've realised it's actually appealing to people who don't understand, who have a very limited interest in football. And what they're having a laugh at is they're having a laugh at stupid people phoning up.
Yep. And unfortunately, that's really what it is. And I mean, I don't listen to Radio. I only listen to Radio Clyde when they've had a horrific result. But just to hear the foaming at the mouth stuff, because I just love it. And in effect, you're probably right, Harry. I'm laughing at stupid people, but there's nothing funnier than laughing at stupid Huns.
But
and I know I shouldn't do it, but I do it. And if Celtic lose, and I know we haven't really had a lot of that this season, I can't listen to it, because you get stupid Celtic fans who haven't been at the game, who haven't seen the game, who are relying on Hugh Keevan's match report or Keith Jackson's article in the game, and you just think, you don't have a clue what you're talking about. And I can't listen when we lose. So I'm not a regular listener. I used to like the Radio Scotland one, but it's got more and more in a Hun-centric of over the last year or so, and I think you might be right. It's because they can't do the games, they're trying to keep them on side. But I can only listen certain nights to that, and if the panel's not appealing, I just switch it off.
So basically what we're saying is Clyde is building its audience based around almost like a zoo. We're going to get stupid people on and you can laugh at them. And Radio Scotland, I don't know what they seem to have just lost their way.
Well, Richard Gordon's not on as much as he used to be, which I think is a big loss, because I think he's a great radio host and presenter. He doesn't do the midweek programmes anymore. He only seems to do the weekend, the Saturday show now.
Mm-hmm. Who, Richard?
Yeah.
He does the live shows.
He does the games, but he doesn't host the sort of hour programme anymore. He was good. I can't abide McIntyre. I just can't abide him.
Well, again, it's also the choice of pundits. You know, Scott McDonald's good, but I'm thinking about the more of the kind of journalist pundits. I mean, I've known, say, for instance, Graham Spears a long time, but, you know, why don't we give somebody else a turn? Steve McGowan's he's a pretty good broadcaster. He knows a lot of things. He knows a lot of people.
They seem McGowan and McGarry appear infrequently.
Very, very occasionally.
Yeah. I can listen to them, and I know Harry's had Stephen on his podcast. And I've met Stephen a couple of times. He's a really nice guy, and he knows what he's talking about, and he does have good contacts. I like it when he's on, although he likes Scotland a bit too much for me. But, you know, he knows what he's talking about. There are some journalists, you know, I know we tend to broad brush slag them, but there are some journalists who know their stuff and who actually love football. For a lot of these journalists that come on, it's a chore. It's like, I think Spears prefers golf and Tom English prefers rugby. So what are they doing in a football programme?
It's like on Clyde, which I genuinely haven't listened to. I remember thinking about maybe 10 years ago now, Hugh Keevans is fed up with being a football journalist in Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
He hates it. I actually got to the point of thinking he hates his job. He hates the industry he works in. So why are you still doing it? So, Lawrence, you're a big one in your journalist, you know, adhering to journalistic standards. If I gave you carte blanche and you were the new producer of Sportsound, what would you do?
I'd get in brand new presenters. I'd probably bring Richard Gordon back to start off with to host that show every night, if he would do it. If not, I would find somebody else, maybe somebody like Chris McLaughlin, maybe. I would keep Tom English. I'd clean out all the Spears would go, I'm afraid, sorry, see you later, Spearsy. Keith Jackson would never darken the door again. I'd find some, there's got to be some new and different voices amongst the journalist community in Scotland.
I've not seen it, but I found out today that apparently the Scotsman online do a tactical analysis.
I do. I've seen the guy. The boy does it. Looks like he could do with a good bath.
Is that Craig Swan? Craig Fowler writes for the Daily Record.
I think the boy does that. The Terrace podcast, Scottish football podcast as well, which I haven't heard. I would get the Ferguson twins. I mean, what on earth are they doing? They would never darken the door again. I'd get more people like I'd just have Scott McDonald on every night. You know, there's a boy. I tell you, else is pretty good. Mark Wilson. I know I'm just naming all like Celtic players.
No, Mark Wilson works for Level 5 and should not be near anything like that.
Well, he's quite good.
I heard Stephen Thompson say on Sportsound on Saturday, the Rangers strikers have been profligate in front of goal.
He's quite a smart guy. I don't mind him.
And I don't mind.
But he didn't use the word calumny like Lawrence did earlier.
I don't mind. There's another one I really like. I object to. Who's the boy from St. Johnstone that's doing the journalism degree? Miller. I can't remember his full name.
Just Miller, yeah.
He's terrible. He wouldn't say boo or goose. He's terrible.
I like Michael Stewart.
Michael Stewart's pretty good.
I don't know if you'll get him because he's in BT, but I like Michael Stewart. At least he gives opinions.
He gives opinions. He wrote a very good column last week on the whole Cathro business. And I know for a fact that there's no love lost between him and Levine. Yet he still wrote a column, a really well-argued, well-reasoned column, believe it or not, in the Scottish Sun.
I actually get the impression Michael Stewart holds back in relation to he'd want to be more... I think at times he wants to be more tactical and talk tactics.
Yeah.
And I think he's been told to rein that in. And I remember him absolutely slaughtering McCoist once, and it was to do with how you train players, how players perform in the park, and to do with tactics and conversation.
He always said that McCoist Rangers team looked as if they hadn't been coached. And I would always like to have him to expand on that and say why, you know. Yeah. But he never, as you say, he's never allowed. It was reined in. But I think he's a smart guy. He's pretty lucid, and he knows what he's talking about, you know. And okay, he played for Man United, and you know, they do all the jokes, but he's played at a decent level, and he is a pretty good pundit, in my opinion. So there are enough about that they could get on. You know, I'd actually love to hear somebody sitting down for an hour with Ian Cathro and just talk to him and get him to talk about what he wants to do and why he would do it and what he actually did do at Newcastle and what he learned at Valencia and what he learned at Rio Ave, because there's very few coaches in Scotland with that level of experience. It's certainly at the age he is.
But instead, what we have right now is, you know, down memory lane with, you know, John Brown or some dud from years gone by, you know, and, oh, tell me about the dressing room bust-ups. It must have been, fists must have been flying, and oh, give us peace.
And because the whole thing about that conversation is the very thing that the BBC would not then want to happen is the only thing of interest would be something that they wouldn't broadcast. Would be something that, you know, that might be libelous if you can't support it. So it then ends up being, yeah, this happened and that happened, and oh, it was a great laugh. And it's not actually getting to the detail of he hated him because he shagged his wife, which is the only bit where those going down memory lanes can be of any value.
They're absolutely brutal, you know. And that, didn't they do a series, that teammate series? And they thought this teammate series was fantastic. It was a monumental bore from beginning to end, I thought. So there's a place for Punch and Judy. I mean, I think BT are doing pretty well with this Stephen Craigan and Chris Sutton stuff. I mean, that's proper Punch and Judy, and that's fine in its place. But by and large, you know, that whole BBC scene is it's an old pals act and needs to be cleaned out. The biggest issue is McIntyre for me, the host. Get a brand new host, a clean slate of journalists, get a brand new group of journalists in. I mean, I know I've gone on about this, stop me from a broken record, but, you know, Ewan Murray would be an excellent panellist on the BBC show. He wrote that great piece on Cathro last week. You know, let's see.
You can't tell your story about, in inverted commas, the old firm.
Well, that's right. But it would be interesting to see if anybody, you know, Malky Mackay is about to be given that Scotland, that SFA job. It'll be interesting to see if there's one dissenting voice anywhere on the spoken media this week, or anywhere on the BBC, if there's a dissenting voice. I expect it'll be a procession of old-time football players, pals of Malky's, large mafia drones, and they'll all say, great appointment. Great appointment. When everybody knows for a fact, if Malky Mackay can't get employed anywhere else, he's only taking the job. Well, for a fact, well, I'm assuming it's a fact, who knows? You know, as soon as, if he got offered a job in England, he'd be off like a shot.
Yeah, just as an aside, I don't actually see what that role ever can do at the SFA, because all the young players are at the clubs. So I don't know what the performance director actually can achieve at the SFA, whether he's good, bad, or indifferent.
Well, it's a ten year process, isn't it?
Yeah, but doing what? Because the clubs do what they want to do with the young players anyway.
Well, you can. I mean, I don't know. Again, they talked about it in this show, that Clyde show. I mean, it's about, well, Austin McPhee had talked about it a while back. The guy who turned the job down. So he obviously knew that he wasn't going to be allowed to do what he wanted to do. You know, it's setting, for instance, they did in Dunfermline. He was talking about what they did in Fife. There used to be four schools of excellence, right? For the four teams in Fife: Dunfermline, East Fife, Raith, Rovers, and another. Can't remember.
Cowdenbeath.
Right. So they all had a youth team. So you had 60 quotes and quotes elite players, and I mean, it was just a joke. So what they did in Fife was they made one team and they put all the money, development money, SFA development money, into one team, 15 players from the whole of Fife. I mean, it's structural stuff. It's boring stuff. It's long-term stuff that needs to be done. And a player like somebody like Malcolm Mackay clearly is in no background in youth development. His background is managing teams, and that's fine. He's managing teams and insulting people. The other point is...
It's 2016, you get to run a country doing that.
Well, but the other thing is, I mean, this guy's going to be in charge of, setting example to kids. With what he's done, I mean, everybody deserves a second chance, but in a job where you're in a position to influence kids and deal with women and...
Don't use your company mobile. That'll be the first thing you'll be telling me.
Snapchat not delete messages? I don't use it, so use Snapchat.
But this is the whole point, getting back to what we've wandered off again, but the whole point, there will not be a dissenting voice heard on the BBC this week. There will not be one, I guarantee you that. If there is, it'll be Tom English, possibly. Right, if Tom's on, he might be off doing the rugby or whatever. Or there might be an old Rangers player needs a spot on the show that night and he won't be able to squeeze his voice in.
You could get a smoke alarm in.
I'll send my smoke alarm on.
Sports Sound Podcast presented by Lawrence Donegan Smoke Alarm. There you go. People would listen to that.
They would. Anyway, now that you've rejigged Sports Sound, we've got a game on Saturday against Dundee. Remy, what's the team? What's the score?
Right, Scott Brown's not playing, so...
Is he not?
Suspended.
Oh.
He's over the booking threshold, so he's suspended on Saturday, so... I think we might see Beaton back in beside Armstrong.
No, I think it'll be Armstrong McGregor.
I hope not. And I think he has to play fullbacks, and I think he has to play only one of Griffiths and Dembele. I think we score more goals as a team with Dembele as a focal point, so I think Dembele's going to play against Rangers, so he's had his couple of weeks we rest, so I think maybe it's time you put him back in the team and see if he can get a goal at home, because he's more likely to score at home than he is away just now.
Has Griffiths scored 2-2 games?
Yep,
and
he has.
Times after the game when Brendan Rodgers has been asked, what do you think of Griffiths? He said, it's a team game.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed that as well, Harry.
It's a team game, and I thought Stuart Armstrong's brilliant.
Yep.
That was very interesting. I thought, there's something there. I'm sorry. I think he'll play. There you go. I'm already excited about Saturday night.
You're already checking Twitter to see if they release the team.
he's just hit the follow and pull the Tim there just to see if he can get it earlier.
Because I'm interested to see how he gets round the... I mean, that'll be his first game where he hasn't played Brown. And has Brown not played? Has there been a game where Brown hasn't played? Competitive game this season?
Can't think of it.
I'm trying to think. Did he play against Alloa? I can't remember.
He would have done because he just plays.
Yeah. Well, he's not playing Saturday. That's for definite.
And the score?
3-0.
Lons? Lons?
No, I'm trying to think here, actually. It's a tricky one, that, actually. It depends on who he plays. I think, will he abandon that experiment after one game, what he did tonight? I mean,
he's
it's kind of
go with two up front, no.
Well, it'd be kind of embarrassing, that. I don't know if he... It'll be interesting, does he have an ego? Will he be...
Of course
he
has an ego, but he learns from things. He's a very clever guy, and he knows what doesn't work.
But
I think he was trying. I think he saw Hamilton will come because did he not play two up front with Motherwell in the League Cup when he thought? And I remember afterwards him being interviewed, and he said something about it was good practice for. Was it not? We were going to be playing a European game, and he said it's good practice for European game where they'll be sitting in. And I think he just thought tonight. I want to have as many attacking players in the park as possible because they're just going to have everybody behind the ball. I think that was his thought process.
You don't think the process was, oh, right, I better just, people are clamouring for two up front.
No,
so.
I don't think he would think that way at all.
No, I don't think he'd think that way at all. He's far too strong-willed to bend to what idiot fans want. You know, he knows what he's trying to do, and you know, he probably did need to try the two up front, but with the no wingers putting the ball in for them, and them crowding each other's areas, it just didn't work. And you know, I think we've scored a barrel load of goals playing one up front. Why not stick to what's been successful?
And the Sinclair coming back will be a big boost for Dembele.
It will be.
So your score, Lawrence?
Oh, see, I've just remembered Sinclair's coming back. Will Forrest be out?
Yep.
Forrest will be out. When Paul Hartley, mind you, how did we get on against him last year? I can't just answer this straight away, Harry. I've got to actually think about this. I've got to run the permutations.
Paul Hartley's retired, Lawrence. He won't be playing.
Although he's still pictured in a Celtic jersey, 2 stone lighter, above the urinals in the North Stand, in the. And what's the? It's one of these things about learning to read charities.
He's still well liked at Celtic Park, Paul Hartley, at the highest level. He's liked.
That's right, because one of the people on this podcast goes to the director's box at games. That's how he knows.
Now, actually, before we move on, Harry, before I give you the score, I see Celtic appointed a new non-executive director last week.
Yes, they have.
Yeah.
And not only have they got a new non-exec director, so fresh blood under the board, which is the purpose of non-exec directors, it's a she.
Mm-hmm. It's a she. That's right. Now, are companies allowed to have, as many NEDs as they want, or is there a limited number?
No, you can have as many as you want. It just starts to be silly if you have too many.
Yeah.
So, yes, that's an excellent move, fresh blood under the board. I was pleased with that. Whether it's a woman or not, you know, the most important thing is that it's somebody who adds value to the company.
So clearly a move designed to head off the rebellion, the Harry Brady-led rebellion at the recent AGM.
I'll still be voting against Tom Allison.
Yeah, they thought Brady and Thompson.
Well, that's right.
There's a quorum now.
Do you know what? They've obviously spotted it. Last year, one person voted. This year, there was two. If it continues multiplying like that,
it's spreading like wildfire.
If it continues to multiply like that, Tom Allison will be off the board in 21-17.
He'll probably still be on it, actually, anyway.
Yeah,
it's going to be Politburo. It really is.
Yeah, it's going to be 4-0, Harry, just deciding.
All right, okay.
Sinclair coming back.
Was that you just killing time so that you could go away and do a Google search?
Exactly. Sinclair will be back. I think Beaton will play. Beaton's got to play, and I think he'll go back. He'll play full-backs again. Although I have to say, I thought Simonovic did pretty well. Simonovic? How do you pronounce it?
Simonovic.
I thought he's beginning to look like a player, isn't he?
He is. I just thought in the last 5 minutes he contributed to the panicky stuff around the back.
The last 5 minutes was just completely out of character with the way they played for the previous 85. They just felt a bit. So it was really, really strange. But Svyatchenko kicked it off with the foul. Well, the one that he was given as a foul to us, and then he changed his mind. And then after that, he was terrible. I don't know what happened to him.
Well, with the positiveness, because I don't want to finish in a
negative. Yes, we won the league table, looks great.
We look great. We're going to score either 3 or 4 goals. And as soon as this podcast, I'm going to tell you about the team who's not going to get to sign people in the summer because agents won't do business with them.
Ooh, can I have a guess?
And I'll say, good night, everyone. Good night, Lawrence.
Good night, Jamie.
Good night, John Boy.
Well, I hope you enjoyed that. As I say, get your change ready for Saturday, Celtic FC Foundation Bucket Collection. As much as you can muster would be fantastic, and we can continue the great work that the Foundation is doing. Next week's podcast will be an interview with Dennis Cunahan by St Anthony. So this is me, Harry Brady, saying goodnight and God bless.